Okay. My name is Shimi Bandiel from Trainologic. We at Trainologic are the Israeli representatives of TypeSafe. I invite you to register at our counter for a chance to win a free course at Scala. And I have quite a challenging presentation here. It's quite a challenge to defend Scala Z and to talk about the good parts. Now, in my opinion, everything is good there, but I know that most do not agree with that. And I could talk about, category theory, functional programming, all these nice things all day, but in 50 minutes, I will try to do it very, very slowly and to focus on some useful practical parts. I'm going to discuss validation, lens, some type classes, and at the end, I'm going to overview some of the more sophisticated stuff, okay? If there are any questions, please raise your hands and I will try to answer them during the session. First of all, how many of you currently use Scala Z? Oh, great, that's a lot. I expected less, okay? Okay, now Scala Z, short story, when I first delivered the Scala training, it was, I think, 2.5 years ago, I made the grief mistake of showing at the beginning some fantastic code from Scala Z. Everyone just lost me from that point on. So Scala Z became quite infamous due to, we can say, lack of documentation, lack of practical examples, a lot of usage of Unicode characters. We will see some of that, but we can use without the Unicode letters. And because of a lot of concepts from category theory, some monoids, monads, and other sophisticated, so-called sophisticated terms, I will try to refrain from it from at least at the beginning. Okay, so very important. We are going to see some examples, of course. And if you are not familiar at all with Scala syntax, be very careful. Do not judge, because, okay, what does this do? Okay, it doesn't really matter. Okay, just be familiar with the syntax. It's very important for this session. Okay? Okay. Well, let's start. I've talked about this. Let's start with some basic stuff, something called type classes. Okay, I know what is a class, object-oriented, Java, Scala, okay. A type class is something that relates to it. Well, actually no, okay. Type class, it's a very sophisticated name for defining some class and defining the so-called instances of this class in a non-inheritance way of object-oriented programming. Let's better see it by an example, okay? And you will see that actually in Scala itself, in the core libraries, there are many type classes, and we'll start with a simple example of equals, type safety equality check. Okay, well, in Scala we have the equals equals operator, which does actually the null safe equals, like the equals in Java, but null safe. But the problem is, okay, I can do an equals equals between a string and an integer. Okay, it will return false, that's good, but it will not scream. It will not say during compilation, okay, you are comparing different types. Are you sure that you mean that? Because there's no way that an integer will be equal to string. Oh, there is a way. If I write some logic that converts the string to an integer. Okay, but usually it doesn't make any sense. And I love compilation errors. I love to find my errors earlier in the code. Now, if we are using Java, in Java a lot of frameworks do not provide type safety. I think the most famous example is, sorry, Hibernate. Have anyone of you worked with Hibernate, for example? Everyone tried it once. Now, Hibernate is a great API. I just have to call some entity manager persist. And it will work, right? So, first try, Java new thread persist. Oh, it compiles, it's okay. It will not work. Oh, I have something like the entity annotation to put. I will put an entity annotation on it. Not on thread, on some other class. It will work? No, you forgot the ID, you forgot this, you forgot that. It will take forever, I will need to read a lot of documentation and... Well, it's not a good API. Pardon. It's not a good API, okay? Now, I like things to fail at compilation. I like TypeSafe. Okay, so what regarding this equals? Okay, I have, you see, the last one. The equals, equals, equals. Now, this is not a Scala built-in operation. This is a Scala Z operation on equal type. Now, int, here I'm invoking it on an int. An int does not belong, it does not extend from equal. So, we know, something with implicits. There is an implicit conversion from int to equal that will allow this operator. Well, everyone does this in Scala design and writing some libraries. But this is the core concept of type classes. We define a class equals, and then we define, not we, but in Scala Z, there is an implicit conversion that converts an int to an instance of equal type class, okay? So, in this example, we are using the built-in conversion. Now, if I wanted to do a different equality check, and we will see an example very soon, I could write my own implicit implementation and use it in my scope. Okay, so it's like, I don't know, it's like in Java, we have the comparable comparator use cases. I can implement comparable, but I can provide comparator for different use cases. But in Java, and it's really limited, it's just for comparator and not for equals, hash code, toString, and a lot of other stuff. Type classes can help me very much here, okay? TypeSafe equality. And here is, for example, I try to compare equals, equals, equals two threads. It will not compile, even if they are of the same type. There's no equality definition. There's not an implicit conversion from thread to an equals class. So it will not compile. I will have to deal with it. And here I've defined an implicit object that will convert from a thread, or it will present an equals instance for the thread class. Okay? I created an instance of the equals type class for working with threads. For example, comparing by IDs. If I have two threads and they have the same ID, they are equal. Okay, and now it will work. Two new threads, it will compile and return false, different IDs. The same thread will compile and print true. Okay? And if you pay attention, you see that I've used inside my definition of the equals thread class, I've used the Scala Z equals between the get IDs. I will not make a mistake here. Less mistakes, better code. Okay? It will fail at compilation time if I use get ID and some, I don't know, get name, for example. Okay, so that was a very simple thing regarding equal. We have some other, a lot of actually, type classes in Scala Z. We have, for example, order. Order, we have the, do you see the code at the end? No, huh? We have the equals pipe, a question mark, pipe question mark. Okay, to say which one is larger than the other one. I provide different types, it will scream. I provide a type, even the same types, without ordering, without an order type class instance present, it will fail in compilation. Okay? Another great example. How many times did you ever print some instance and got the name of the class, at and some address? Because you forgot to implement a toString or something like that. No, never happened to you. Of course. It's only me. Regarding Scala Z, we have the type class show. Object.show. If there is a show instance for that type, okay, it will work. It will print it. If there is no show instance, it will not work. Example. 1.show. There is a built-in show instance for int, it will work. For string also. For thread, will not compile. I can provide a show instance. I have also some helper factory, so-called methods, which print the get name of the thread. And now, thread.show, thread zero, or some other name that you gave your thread. Okay? You will never, ever get the type at some address. It's not meaningful. Okay? Moreover, if you have different places in your application that you want to print, for example, in verbose mode or in, I don't know, some internationalization code, you can override, you can provide different implicits, different instances to the type class. Okay? So it's very handy, very useful, and you don't need to know what a category theory is at this part. Okay? Okay, no more printing combo mom x or something like that. Okay, so this was very nice to get into, but okay, it must be more than that, you know, it weighs a lot of you know, kilobytes in compiled code, the Scala Z library. There must be something else there. Okay, let's take a look at something more complicated, more useful, more, you know, it's more meat inside it. Lens. Okay. Now, I very like to work with immutable data. I'm big favor of stateless, immutability, functional programming, you know. And one of the pains in working with immutable data is the need to change it. Okay, yeah, I know it's an oxymoron, you know, change an immutable data instance. You know, what does it mean? Means to change immutable type to create it anew. Okay, so I have a person, I want to change the age, I need to create a new person with the age. Now it's, if you work with case classes, we have out of box copy method that will make our life easier. Let's take a look at a simple example here. I have three case classes. Okay, customer stock and stock portfolio, which is a map of stocks and the customer, and I have age and the name, and for stock I have the name and the price, and I have some data. Not big data structure, but big enough for our discussion. So let's say that I have my portfolio as an immutable data structure. I want to change the price of a stock, the name of the person, or not the name, the age. Okay, in order to change the age, we need to create a new person, new customer, with the new age. And how do I put it in the stock portfolio? Oh, I will need to create the stock portfolio, a new instance with the new customer. And things get very ugly if I want to change the price of a stock. You know, I need to create the stock as a new instance. I need to create, to put it in the map, to replace. I cannot replace an immutable data structure. So I need to create the map anew, with the new stock instead of the old one. And I need to create after that the stock portfolio with the new map, and it will get very, very, very verbose in a big data structure. What I can do, I can work with lens. Now, with lens, I will still have some verbosity, unless I will use macros, which I will not show here. Eugene will talk about macros. One of the great use cases, I think, is working with lens. But I will show you lens. Okay? So, let's see what I have here. I have, let's start with customer. I have a value customer, John, age of 30, and I want to be able to change the name, the age, things like that. Okay, I define two lenses. What is a lens? A lens is actually a combination of getter and setter. I've talked about immutable data structure, there is no setter. Okay, the getter, quite obvious, I can get the value, and the setter will replace a new and put a new value in a new instance of the object, of the a copy of the object with the new value. Okay, let's see how I define it. Customer age, this will be a lens for changing the age of the customer without changing it. I'm using the lensu. I don't know how to pronounce it. I hope it is correct, lensu. And I said that regarding the generic types, it's the base object is customer, and the field type that I want to work with is int the age. And I provide two things, setter and getter, a tuple. At the end of the tuple, the right side, I have the getter from a customer A, get the age. And on the left side, from a customer and a new value for age, I copy the original and put inside the age the new value. That's it, setter and getter. Very easy, very nice to work with it. You can see it later on. I can say customer age set John to 31. And I will have now John a new instance of John with age 31 instead of 30. Okay, so far it I don't see where I benefit from it. Okay, let's see some other things I can do. I can, for example, use the very strange operator called the percentage equals. Okay, customer age, this is a lens that focuses on the age of a customer, and I want to perform a transformation on the age and add it one, increment it. Now I can call it increment customer age. I have a lens that will increment the age of the customer. I can reuse existing lenses in order to provide some more meaningful, transformations. Okay? And here is how I use it. Increment customer age, I provide John, I get actually the John and 31 and also the value. Okay, I have some more operators. I will not go here into all the operators regarding lens. But the more important stuff comes when I define several lenses. Let's talk about it. I have stock, okay? Stock as a name and price. I define lens to change the price of a stock. I can also define a lens to change the name of the stock, but this is not meaningful, I think, because, I don't know if a stock ever gets its name changed. Okay, and now, I also provide a lens to change the customer inside a portfolio. Okay, portfolio is composed of a map of stocks and the customer. I want to be able to change the customer. Again, getter and setter. Okay, I also provide a lens to change the map itself, receive a new map. Another lens. And you see, I'm repeating my lenses, and this is because I don't have macros here. Okay, if we're using macros, I can auto-generate all these lenses automatically, the simple and trivial ones. Okay, and take a look at the last line. After I have a lot of lenses, I can compose them. And here comes the great power of lenses. The great power of lenses. Okay, I can take the portfolio stocks, which is a lens that focuses on portfolio, okay? And focuses on changing the map, and then I compose it with built-in lens provided in Scala Z, that can change a value inside a map. Okay? Out of box, you get some lenses for working with data structures, and I have a lens that can replace a value according to a key. Okay? Of course, it creates a new map. Needless to say, it's immutable. Okay? I'm saying, okay, I want to change the sample the sample stock, sample one stock inside the portfolio stocks, and then I want to change its price and set the price to 9,999. Okay? And what you can see is I'm getting here a new object of stock portfolio with a new generated map. It's not the original one because the original one is immutable. With a new stock for sample one with a new price. So actually quite a lot of new objects were generated here with a single line. Okay, and it is as readable as you like if you provide more readable names than I did, for example. Okay, so, yes, sorry. Yeah, sure, here. I have, this is one lens, this is another one, okay? Instead of using, I'm sorry. Yeah, you can, you know, I can in not do it the set here. Without the set, it's a lens. The left side of the set, it's a lens. I can put it in a value and reuse it and even compose it with higher level lenses. You know, if I have some higher level of my data structures, I can compose it as I like. Okay, very nice. Very nice. Now you may say, okay, it's very nice, but change everything, create new objects on every invocation, on any performance. Okay? Okay, I'm not going to go deep into performance now, but I will say this. If it's your bottleneck, don't use it. Okay? I doubt that this will be your bottleneck, but if this is your bottleneck, you know, use something else. But remember on the JVM, short living objects are cleared very efficiently, so creating more and more objects and then discarding them is quite cheap on the JVM. So actually, I will not suffer greatly from performance problems here. Compilation times are a different scenarios, okay? Working with Scala Z, takes some time to compile the things, but I get type safety, I get reusability. Okay, this is a very, very nice feature in Scala Z. Okay, any questions for now regarding lens? Yes.
I'm trying to figure out why this is another case of using the immutable, because it is data
changes. Why use immutable? Why not use mutable objects? Well, the problem with mutable objects is they are not thread safe. And this means that it's more harder to understand where the value came from, and usually leads to more bugs. And by the way, I ask in every training that I do, what is the most important thing in code? And usually I get the code should be readable. Of course, the code should be readable, but this is my actually third priority. Okay, first priority, it should work. Okay, I wonder why no one mentions it. okay, it should work. Okay, if I can find my bugs during compilation time using type safe mechanisms, the more the merrier. Second thing, I don't want to provide support for my code. I hate support. Okay, so I want to provide an API that cannot be used wrongly, not like Hibernate. They made a lot of money from support, by the way. But, you know, I want to work like this. For example, if we were to think how to write Hibernate from the scratch, I would use type classes. I would define an entity type class, and then I would provide implicit, you know, and start working that direction. Okay, providing type safety, providing everything for IDs, well, that way. Okay, another scenario, yes.
In the previous example, if you want to change every price of every stock, can you, will it create new inf- instances of map for every step, or you can somehow combine them so they are calculated lazily once creating one new map.
Okay, I will just repeat the question. If I wanted to change all the prices of all the stocks inside the map, will I need to recreate the map on every step? I can think of several approaches. One of them is yes, create a map on every step, but in constant time, O of one. Okay, use some map that is backed by a linked list and just prepend a value for it. For example, like if you work with list, Scala list, and you try add another, immutable, but on every addition, you create a new list, but it's O of one. So maybe I can go in that direction. Maybe I can use some mutable map during the process, but it will be hidden from the user. I have several approaches, okay? Okay, another very interesting class or type class actually is validation. Okay, some of us need to validate data. Okay, and validation is usually very painful because I don't want to throw exceptions. I hate exceptions. Exceptions fall just into the slot of support. I do something, I throw an exception from the other team, they will come to me. It's not working. What doesn't work? Oh, I don't know, I got something. I saw your code there in the stack trace. Okay, what happened? Oh, I have a stack trace here, what does it say? Oh, the message is incorrect value, 5, should be 4. What did you send? 5, oh, sorry. I don't want to get there. I don't want to throw exceptions, okay? I want maybe to fail fast, okay, on the first validation error to just provide the customer with a way to deal with it, or maybe to aggregate all of the validation errors and provide the customer with a way to deal with it. So let's see how to work with validation in Scala Z. Okay, let's work. First of all, the basic class will be person, okay? This is a scenario when I want to apply for a public institute for work. Okay, so my data is a person has a name, age, years in education, and whether or not the person is a citizen in the country. Okay, so the first example. Before the first example, the API. The validation methods. I define several validation methods. One to validate the age, one to validate whether the person is a citizen or not, and the third one to validate the education, the number of years. Okay, for check education, I get a person and I return an error. I will talk about it in a minute. An error if the age is below 12. Okay, I don't know. No, I'm sorry. Years of education, below 12 years, it's a failure, cannot apply for the job, otherwise success. Regarding the citizenship, if he is not a citizen, fail, otherwise success. Regarding the age, less than 18, too young, otherwise success. Okay, the validation class in Scala Z provide us with two type parameters, the left side and the right side. By convention, the right side is the okay value. What the method, what the validation object will contain if the validation was successful, okay? In all of my examples, I'm reusing the same type. I was provided with a person, I will return the same person on success scenario. On failure scenario, the left side, I decided to use a string, the validation error message, okay? I can use other types, we will see something later, but for now, a string. And you can see I have the methods fail and success. In order to lift or convert or transform a value into fail or success types. And you can see, regarding the string, I do a fail, it will wrap it with validation, with the left side, with the string. If it was success, a validation object with right side of the person will be created. Okay, now this is very simple. I can create many, many, many validation methods. Now let's see how to use them. first example. Let's say that I write an object ministry of else, okay? The person tries to apply to the ministry of else. In the ministry of else, I will use the famous four comprehensions of Scala, okay? Validation can be used in four comprehensions. I am tempted to say it's a monad, but let's put it aside. It can be used in four comprehensions. Okay, let's see. Check education, check citizenship, check age. Okay, if I reach the bottom level, it didn't fail, and I will just yield. Congratulations, you got the job. Okay, let's see how to use it. First usage, John, age 30, 15 years of education, first degree, and citizenship false. This will print, failure must be citizen. It's okay. Okay, next, Shraga. Age 30, 15 years of education, citizenship true. Okay, success, Shraga, you got the job. And last one, Danny, I'm sorry. 13 years of age, 5 years of education, citizenship true. We have two problems here, the age and the education. Now, when we used four comprehensions with validation, this is a fail fast. It means I will only get the first problem. The computation will stop at that time, okay? It will not continue to check more validations. So I will get failure, not enough education, and I will know nothing about the age. I will need to fix this maybe and then return and then get the age error. Okay, but this is a correct and useful scenario if you want to fail fast. Okay, second attempt. In the Ministry of Transportation, okay, they do things differently. They present all of the validation exceptions, so to called exceptions. Okay, so how does this work? With the introduction of the Macaulay-Culkin operator. Okay, this will, I'll just skip. Okay, a pipe at pipe, okay? Not my copyright, but very nice, okay? Okay, so I'm just building, it's actually something, it's called an applicative builder, but let's drop the fancy names. It will just aggregate all the validation problems. You see, I'm performing one validation, performing another one, and then if it succeeded, okay, I will just print, you know, you got the job. And let's see what happens here. I will get for the third example, the first two are the same, but the third example with the two validation exceptions, I will get, oh, a concatenated string. It took the two strings and concatenated them. It's not good. I don't want now to start and parse it and break the string that is not enough education too young. No, it's not good enough. Oh, maybe the problem was that I worked with strings, but I don't want to go and change my validation methods, okay? Can I do something else? Of course you can. It's Scala Z, you can do everything. First of all, if you like Unicode characters, instead of the Macaulay-Culkin operator, you can use the, I don't know how to call it, it's a star inside the circle, okay? Circle star. I don't know how to type it, I just copied it from the Scala Z sources. But you can always use some combination of characters to do it, okay? And it's just nice to have in our Eclipse. It just took one day, I think, to install the Unicode font on the machine. Okay, but to the more important stuff, I'm just converting or transforming the validation type into a non-empty list. Okay, instead of concatenated string, I want to work with a list of the messages and build them you know, add more messages into the list. And I'm working with non-empty list because if there is a validation error, the list will not be empty ever. Okay, so I'm just saying, you know, two validation on empty list, two validation on empty list, two validation on empty list, and then the message will be non-empty list of not enough education and too young. And I can work with that, you know, just now loop about it with four comprehensions or something like that and present it nicely to the user. Okay, so this is actually quite useful, and I'm reusing my validation methods in order to perform validation. Okay, I've shown you this. Okay, what if we have a lot of methods for validation? I don't want now to just, you know, concatenate everything and type all of my methods. Let's say I have a list of, or a sequence or a traversable of validation methods. Okay, what I can do now is copy-paste this code, okay? I'm not going to go deep into traverse. There are more fancy methods like this in Scala Z, but there is a way to just, you know, traverse the list and concatenate all the validation messages and just, you know, provide my business logic for what happens if everything succeeded, okay? I will not go into the implementation details of this example. I think the presentations will be available and you can just look at it, okay? But also I have this way, okay? I have the two previous ways which were simpler to understand and to, you know, to write by ourselves. And I have the, okay, more sophisticated way when working with a collection of validation methods. Okay, just an example. Okay, some more things regarding validation. You may encounter the famous Scala Z type, which is \\. Okay, in regular Scala, we have the type called either. Either, or again, left and right, left for problematic scenarios, right for the right path and the actual good type. It can be used for validations also. The problem with either in Scala is you cannot use it in four comprehensions, okay? It's less powerful than the types inside, yes? Okay, yes, you can do it. I'm saying that they did something like that. I know, it's the, do you know how to pronounce it? Disjunction, okay, disjunction, \\. Okay, disjunction operator, yeah. Okay, okay, we have also this one, which is very similar to validations, okay? Okay, yes, okay, so, I will do now a short, quick overview on some more famous, you know, type classes inside Scala Z without actually, you know, going into the category theory behind them. But, okay, we have, everybody heard, at least heard about the notion of functor. Okay, and I'm not going into the, again, the explanations, the mathematical explanations, but actually you have worked a lot. If you worked with Scala, you worked a lot with functor. It's almost everything that has the map operation, the transformation operation. I have a list of int, I want to transform it into a list of string. I have an option of int, I want to transform it into an option of string. And I have a simple method that converts an int to a string. I can reuse it in different contexts, okay, for these transformations. Now, in Scala, there is nothing that unifies all of these classes that allows us this transformation ability, what is called the functor. Scala Z provides us with the functor type class, which just says, okay, instances that belong to this type can be mapped over, can be transformed using a function to a different, to the same context with a different type. And here is a very nice example. I can now write something close to metaprogramming. I can define a method that receives some functor of int and say, okay, I just want to, you know, increase the int with 5. That's it. I don't care what this functor is. It can be a list, okay? It can be an option. It can be actually any instance of functor, okay? Which is very nice, okay? I can have now a type class for these types, these kind of classes, okay? So this one is very nice to understand. Applicative, we've seen an example with the validation, with the, you know, the Macaulay-Culkin operator, okay, which is very nice. I can take two options, not validations, two options, and then say, okay, what I want to do is, you know, sum the values inside of them, okay? So we've seen something like that. And, okay, I can also, and this is important, I can take, okay, I have two options with int, and I want to concatenate, to add something, okay, which is not an option, but a regular int. In Scala Z, you have the method point. Point will take a simple value and wrap it with the context. For example, I take 6, point of option, I will get an option of 6, actually a sum. I can point to a list or to many, many other types, okay? And here I can just, you know, now I have 3 options, I can use the operator and just sum them. Yeah, I know you can use it with 4 comprehensions because these classes also support a flat map, but even if not, I can still use this kind of syntax. Okay? And last example, which is, I'm not going to talk, I will return to this slide at the end, okay? Just another very, very nice example, a nice feature is memoization. Well, a big word for saying a cache, okay? I don't want to repeat my computations if they are, you know, stateless and they are purely functional. The same input will always result in the same output. So how hard is it to implement some cache like that? Oh, it's very simple. Let's see this example. I have some method here that will return always 1, but has a delay of 50 milliseconds, okay? And now I write some very nice and famous method for factorization, okay? I will receive some int, and I will recursively and not tail recursion, okay? Just because I didn't, you know, it's not this kind of presentation. Take a number and, you know, recursively compute the factorization, but call delay on every step, okay? And I measure it. I have here factorization of 50, of 10, of 50, and it took, you know, around 5 seconds. But I say, okay, this is very useful example to demonstrate memoization. Okay, if I computed some value, I don't want to recompute it. Okay? So I only need to add, no, it's not a one line, it's, you know, one method. Memo, the type class, and mutable hash map memo. What does this do? This will, on each invocation, will take the parameters, create them as key, compute the result, and put it in a value inside the map. And on next invocations, it will check whether the arguments are present in the map. If so, it will return the value from the map, and that's it. A cache mechanism, okay? But with a single line, it drops to 2.5 seconds, 50%. And I have different strategies. I have mutable maps, immutable maps, arrays, weak hash map, if I want my memory to automatically clean up, you know, if GC is working. And I can create my own strategies. Very nice, very simple. You do not need to use Spring async feature and start a container for it, okay? Built in inside our library, we have it. Okay? And last but not least, I return to this. slide, monads, to shorten it up, everything that can be used in four compressions, a lot of instances inside Scala Z regarding IO, state, writer, reader, very interesting stuff, okay? You can just take a look at an example, okay? Just know how to work with it, okay? Of course, it will benefit you to understand the deep grounds of it, but it is not mandatory, okay? It's not mandatory, you can use it, you can benefit from it, you can write type-safe, immutable, purely functional, and if you like Haskell, it provides you its almost Haskell-like API inside Scala. And now it's time for questions, if you have any. Yes?
I have one. So, probably there are other libraries in Scala ecosystem that do same things as Scala Z, say Shapeless, right?
Great
actually,
library.
Scala Z's maintainer, Lars Cooper, is also a contributor to Shapeless. What's your stance on that? Is, for instance, would it be a good idea for Scala Z and Shapeless to merge? Or would it be a good idea for Scala Z to acquire some of the features from other libraries, and so on?
Well, I like both of these libraries. It's a tough question. If they would merge, it will be, I think, very, very nice, you know, for the community. And I use some features of Shapeless, and I use some features of Scala Z, and they are both great libraries, you know.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, mostly complimentary, though. I mean, I don't recall seeing... There probably are tiny features for the overlap, but for the most part, they know that, you know, where something like is already solved, they do it.
Yeah, I agree. I use them both, you know. They are great.
Is there any part of Scala Z that you would recommend not to use?
Okay, is there a part of Scala Z that I would recommend not to use? Okay. I like Unicode. No, it's very nice, but no, it's not the a part not to use. I don't like, you know, just using stuff because it's there. Okay? I would recommend use it if you need it. Okay, I think this is the most important notion because there are a lot of, you know, there are clay-less arrows. Okay, very nice stuff, very nice, very nice concept. It's useful in some cases, but just using it because it's there. In every framework, it's like that, I think, you know, using something just because it's there and I don't really need it and it just complicates stuff. That's it, you know, there are a lot of great things there. I'm not familiar with something that doesn't work or causes problems if you are using the right, you know, the right use case for it. Just, you know, and also don't try to use something that you don't understand, okay? You don't have to understand it totally, but you have to at least grasp the basic notion behind it, I think, okay?
Well, I actually have another question. So, since Scala Z provides a lot of useful abstractions, and this is not tongue-in-cheek, yeah, they're really useful, should we adopt them in Scala Library to jar?
Oh, that's a good question. Should you adapt it inside the core library? Some parts of it, I think, yes, and a lot of parts, no. Because, you know, it's there. I have no problem just, you know, take it and using it. The thing I think that should not be done is trying to, you know, implement some features that you know, how to state it. I don't have a problem with something that is not inside the core libraries in Scala and is in other libraries. I have problems with things that are in the Scala library and, you know, they could have been implemented, I don't know if to say better or different, things like that, you know.
Could you give an example?
Excellent.
Could I give an example? Actors and XML.
Simple one, before Brush in the show with the non-lazy. with maps. It's written in Star Z for phone writers. You can have lazy operations to write phone writers to stop the stream. More generic.
Fold right, yeah.
I'll give you the generic one.
Okay.
The setting of personal challenges and adopting sky and organization is recipe getting people to claim about it. Things are in the style of dialogue, then they will be predicting it. Very hard to control what you could use in the style of dialogue. So claim organization, I can ban scan scholarly. Because maybe you think 10% of it is useful, I don't want others to start using 90% and everyone has to be the whole thing. So that's another consideration. Maybe the scope of the language and make it modular.
Okay.
And there's another, there's already too many instances where you do stuff in very different ways and
yes.
get the same behavior. Scala Z is almost exponential. It's not, if you come at some point, you start to look at the trail right only if you know. You have so many symbols.
I don't like comparison to Perl inside.
Yeah,
okay.
If you look at some answers on the web, sometimes if you do this and then you have star, dot star, the holy parking star, if you do that, if you forget one star, if you get something else, and then find out where it goes.
It's considered obscene.
Yeah.
But there's a part in the MA monorail where you have the operator with one star, two stars, three stars, all of them are different ones. And if you miss one star, you're still on a compiler, but you get excited because you don't understand it, you don't know why.
You wish upon a star.
This is probably part of the fun that wraps and engulfs Scala Z. Scala Z is also very hard to understand, but and it got some very awesome jobs, like the functors and like validations and like method, which is, I think, why Jimmy chose these.
Instead of monad transformers, which are great, by the way.
Is there any ongoing effort to break Scala Z?
Actually, there are some parts inside Scala Z, for concurrent.
It's all coding Scala Z. All of the sample that I use is learning how to equal the Scala Z objects.
You can talk.
You know what?
The specific features, yeah. Today, no, you can import specific features. But it's inside the same job.
For a specific feature, and then you get everything, and people start to use it. Yes. You know, to sum it up, it's quite a challenge to use it. It has a lot of nice features, and you can actually educate yourself and learn new stuff, which is also important by working with Scala Z and trying to write some code with it. But the most important thing, you can end up with less code, more usable code, and more types of code using Scala Z, which from my point of view is number one priority, from my point of view, and I would like to thank you. Okay, thanks.